Hall of Fame broadcaster Marty Brenneman here, and he's the best storyteller in the game, and it's time to sit back, relax, and have some laughs. Welcome to the mayor's office, and here's your host, Sean Casey.
Big boom, Chinchy! A big boom today!
Super boom! What's happening here? This is our 100th episode. Should we call it a jubilee? Should we call it an extravaganza? A palooza? Yeah. Is it a mayor's office palooza? What do we got? 100 episodes?
Yeah, just incredible. Incredible. It's so funny, bro, looking back at this podcast. When we first started it, I think we did a run one night. We're like, all right, let's do a trial run. And it went so bad. I was like, maybe we shouldn't do this, you know? And then remember we were like, hey, let's get the 10 episodes, see where we're at, and then we'll go from there. And then we started getting the guests. I think, remember Adam Dunn was our first guest?
First guest, sixth episode. Yep.
Yeah, and then things start rolling from there, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Nobody wanted to just hear you and me talk about stuff. They had to bring a guest in. So.
Yeah, but we got a lot of your stories in early from back in the day, like the suntan lotion stuff where you only got half a tan. We had, what else, when you ate all the bratwurst and pooped yourself all over Milwaukee.
There's so many stories, bro. There's so many stories,
but then we started getting guys
$2 tip.
Dude, the $2 tip, you told the story, and then Adam Dunn
And then Dunner came on and told the story. Yeah,
and then every other 99 Red came on and told that story. Which also, for me personally, dude, I got to thank you, because I've made such good friends out of this. You know, Danny Graves, one of the greatest guys I've ever met in my life. I got to talk to him, and we've associated since we had him on. But your guys, the real thing to me is, like, looking back and forget about all the personal stuff with it, but like your relationship with those guys and that fraternity that you guys have, and that goes all the way to the announcers and the coaches and everybody. We've had so many guys on from those Reds teams, and it's so cool to gain friendship for me with them, but you get to go down memory lane with those guys. Has been really sick and fun, right?
Now, you know, it's funny. I'm reading a book right now by this guy named Dan Coyle, great guy, called The Culture Code. He also wrote a book called The Talent Code, which is great. And he talks about in any great culture, as human beings, we want to feel safe and connected. And I look back at that 99 Reds team. We had such a great mix of veteran guys and young kids. You know, we were a lot of young guys, me and Pokey Reese and Dimitri and Booney and all the guys that we, Danny Graves, all the guys we had on. And then you had like Harnish and Greg Vaughn and Lark and all those guys. And I think that was the big thing, bro. We felt safe with each other and we felt connected. We did a lot of dinners together. We did all that stuff. So when we got on the field, you know, and that's why I can't stand when people are like, well, chemistry doesn't really matter. Bullshit. You know, we're human beings, and go look at any team that wins,
right?
You know, and they really broke down Greg Popovich, what he does with the San Antonio Spurs, all that stuff. But like, I look back at that 99 Reds team, and the reason those guys come on this show and talk so fondly is because we were so connected, and we had some great leaders, and it was incredible, incredible year, bro.
Yeah,
incredible
so year. Awesome.
That's incredible, guys. Who have we had on from those teams? Obviously, we had, we had Dunner. Mm-hmm. No, Dunner wasn't on that team, but that team built the foundation of what the Reds was about. Right. That's why Kernsey talks about it. Dunner talks about it. Rietzma talked about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we had on Greg Vaughn. We had on Gravy. We had on Harnish. You know, we've had on some
middle infielder. Who's the infielder guy?
We had on Dimitri.
Dimitri. Who's the infielder guy that does college baseball stuff now? Awesome dude. Greatest dude.
Todd Walker. No, Rock was a couple years later, but he was still in that Reds. I'm telling you, that Reds environment, man. The environment he had there was second to none, brother. Second to none.
Awesome. Cool. And then it's also cool we've been able to have our mutual friends on, you know, because I worked with a lot of guys like Dan Plesac, Al Leiter, Kevin Millar, D-Row, Tomei.
Yeah, I mean, Cliffy Floyd.
So much fun. So great. I'm so psyched.
Dude, also having CeCe Sabathia on early.
Dude.
When we were talking about Montez,
what's his name? The trainer.
Yeah. We're talking about
Fernando
Montez.
Yeah.
I mean, talk about drill sergeant, bro. I was like, are we the Navy? Are we doing budge training? Or are we minor league baseball players and big leaguers? When you see Manny Ramirez riding around for fat camp, and you're like, and he's got no bike, no seat on. You're like, Manny Ramirez is riding a bike with no seat on it because he's in fat camp because Fernando Montez said so. And I'm like, He's one of the best hitters in the game right now. But Fernando Montes says, no, you're in fat camp. Yeah. Figure it out. So when CeCe and I got talking about Fernando, man, dude, I'm telling you, so you came good. Up in the minor league system with Fernando. You're like, buckle up, boys, because we don't know if it's Navy SEAL training or
or you're fired. Yeah. No, I'm going to keep pumping our chest out right now because we are so proud. Everybody, and we're going to get to you folks that have been following us this whole time towards the end of the show and give you guys a little special shout out. Maybe we'll give away some stuff later. We'll see. But, like, it's just been so awesome and so much fun, and we are so proud of this because, like you said, 10, like, let's get to 10. We've just gone to 100. I don't care what anybody says. It is not easy. We've both had COVID at different points during the show. We've done shows where, you know, you're away right now, but we're doing a 100th episode. You're on vacation right now, like in Shark Island, wherever you are.
This morning I did like, I went down to the beach. I'm like, all right, I'm going to go in. Nobody was there. Sun had just come up. I'm like, all right, I'm going to go in. And then I got you in my head talking about those sharks on Long Island. I'm like, I'm at the Jersey Shore. I'm like, you could do it, man. You could do it. So like, I put my earplugs in so I could hear, you know, water in my ears. I'm just waiting there, and I'm thinking of David Goggins, you know, the Navy SEAL, says, I hate sharks, that's why I swim in the ocean. I'm just like, I hate sharks, that's why I'm in the ocean. And I stayed in for like 5 minutes, bro, grinding through it.
Wow, good for
and
you.
And I was thinking about last year, a year ago at this time, we were in Newport, Rhode Island, and that's when we got Pedroia on.
Right.
He was our first guest on location.
Great story about how he said all this. He coaches his 9-year-old kid, right? And I said, what was it like when the other guys come try to talk to you about how the kids should hit and whatever? He goes, I tell you one thing. He goes, you guys are talking about getting championship rings at 9 years old? Come to my house. You can polish my 3, motherfucker. Still one of the best lines we've ever heard.
Vintage Petey, man. Vintage Petey. Yeah. It's just so classic.
And
dude,
yeah, and the guests just kept coming. How about Peter Gammons talking about when
Mattingly gave him the cross? Yeah, unbelievable, dude. Yeah. Peter Gammons, when we were talking to Pete, it was like he's like a baseball treasure, man. The stuff that Peter has, the stories that he has in his mind, Ted Williams and all these guys, Wade Boggs throwing batting practice, all that stuff. When he had the stroke, Don Mattingly sends him his cross. Mm-hmm. I mean, bro, Peter Gammons, we could do a show, 20 hours
with
Peter.
Just on him. It would
be scratching the surface of the the history that guy has.
So many things like that. And another thing that I'm so proud of is like when we, you know, I always say we do a lot of kicking the nuts jokes, but we do have some serious stuff that we get really fired up about. And to hear these guys' story, you mentioned that one. That just made me think of Danny Graves, his mom in Vietnam and going back to Vietnam, being the first Vietnamese professional baseball player is an amazing story.
Carlos Pena moving from Dominican after that good jobs, moving up to the States, living in their uncle's attic for 2 months and while they grinded to all sleep together up there and then, you know, figure it out, getting, you know, so Carlos could have a better life. Crazy.
Amazing. Yeah. Also, we got to have Curtis Granderson on because all of the great stuff he does with the Player Tribune and it's just, I'm just so proud to be a part of this with you, man. And we started so silly and so weird, and it's really, it's been great. We've had, you know, like, some of the ladies at the game that have taken things to the next level.
Waldman was unbelievable. Jess Mendoza. You kidding me? Like, these are trailblazing women. You know what I mean? That have done some amazing things in the game. It's unbelievable. And then going, you know, I think the big thing is if you listen to this show, we're big on the mental game of baseball, but I think the mental game of life is going to continue to trickle in, you know, to this show. You know, I have my buddy Brian Johnson on, who started the Heroic, who's been a dear friend of mine. Also Optimize, Michael DeSani, who's just been a big influence in
the
my
two
life.
Wolves, that two wolves story. He told the story about the two wolves. Which wolf you're going to feed?
Mark Devine, you know, decorated commander of the Navy SEALs. Mm-hmm. I mean, just him talking about, box breathing and all the things that he does every day and being committed. I mean, just those guys are awesome. We're going to continue to have, you know, as we continue to meet new friends in life, well, hopefully we continue to have some of those guys on. But I know the fans and a lot of people that have been listening, we had a guy on, Tim McMahon.
My buddy.
Tim McMahon had on recently about Push the Tarp.
Was saying
that he box breathes every day because of the Mark Devine episode we did. So I was like, let's go.
Absolutely. Let's go. Yeah, no, I've learned a lot of that stuff. I'm telling you, there are some days where I'm all cranky, where I'm like, let me do some of this breathing stuff that Casey told me about. And it does work, man. It works, man. Yeah, and actually, wait, let's stop right there right now, because we're going to start a new segment in the show, because it is cool that – a lot of our stuff. Perfect example, when we had Al Leiter on, one of my favorite segments we've ever done was when you guys started talking about Harvey Dorfman, and you just started breaking out all your books about his mental game of baseball, all different things. But we want to do something now, because, like, you know, Sean is extremely learned about this stuff, and it's really kind of changed your life, like the heroic stuff and all that. Explain that a little bit, and then we'll talk about our new segment.
Heroic,
we're
gonna do. Heroic, you know, was started by Brian Johnson, my buddy, who was on the podcast. Such a genius of a guy. Started Optimize, where he read 1,000 books, 600 books, really, but he read over 1,000, where he put them into philosopher's notes. So if you go to the Optimize app, is now in Heroic. But the Heroic app, bro, it's incredible. Yeah. What you do is, it's like your game of life. You know what I mean? It's like literally like the game of life. You draw the lines, you start to figure out, you know, your energy, work, and love, the routines and the habits that you're gonna create every day. And then you shoot arrows every time you do something and you hit a target, bam, I shoot an arrow, bam, I shoot an arrow. And it's a scientifically proven method to get you to really lock in your routines, lock in your habits. And it's changed my life. And so I encourage all our listeners, go download the Heroic app. It is a game-changing app that will help your life in so many different ways. So we're going to start doing, you know, I think it's an app of service. Being heroic is about serving others, and we think this podcast is a service to our fans that listen to, a service to us too. So we're going to start doing the Heroic person of the week. And we would also love for all the listeners out there, send us stuff in. If you have a story that you want to put on the Mayor's Office podcast, send it to us.
Doesn't have to be a celebrity. Doesn't have to be anything. Yeah. It could be a teacher, one of your kids' teachers. It's just a really special person, or you know, a family member who just you know, finished 40 years working in a tough industry. Anything like that, send it along to us, and we're going to talk about it. You want to start? I found one today.
All right, give it to me.
Okay, so our heroic person of the week,
first heroic person of the week on the Mayor's Office. Let's go.
This guy is, this is actually hero level. Like, we're going to have some, like this dude, his name was Ro Malabanan, which I will hopefully said that right. This dude is a mixed martial artist, okay, like a professional, like badass dude, okay? He's walking down the street in Soho, a couple days ago, and there was this homeless person who, we see a lot of that in New York these days, a lot of mental illness going on, whatever, but I guess this person has been consistently walking around the neighborhoods and sucker punching people and knocking them down, knocking them out. Unbelievable, which is terrible. But so this homeless guy, I guess, had just hit this construction worker, big tough dude, but he wasn't looking. Of course, you get hit, you go down. This man jumped into action, ran over to the guy and says, "Are you all right?" He's like, "I'm not great." And a couple other people came over there and they're like, "This guy's been doing this for months and months. We can't stop him," whatever. This guy gets on his horse, tells them, "Call the police, take care of your friend. I'm going to go get him." Him and a couple other guys start chasing this guy. It took him like 3-4 blocks to catch him. Took him down, put him in a hold, got the guy away, got the guy the help he needed for whatever the reasons he was doing those horrible things to people, and this guy saved an entire neighborhood of Soho. So we give him credit.
I think that's a good Malabanan.
Yes.
A big row.
I think that's a good first hero. That's like Batman heroism.
Yeah, exactly, dude. That's next level. We were just talking about, hey, send in your grandparents, your grandfather. This guy's actually taking out people and actually getting them help, but saving other people while he's doing it. So that's very, very valiant. That's unbelievable. Right. That's here. That's called being a hero.
All right. So there you go, buddy. You're our first one ever, and nobody more deserving. Especially, you know, take time out of your day, put yourself in danger to take care of the neighborhood. I love that. I love that kind of thing. That's like the Chinchaminos did that in Brooklyn back in the day, but nobody knows. Yeah,
kids, if you walked up to somebody to take him out, like the guy was like, bam, he would take you out. Yeah. Like, which Chinchamino went to help out? Next thing you know, guy.
Yeah, but anyway, so like, I hope you guys like that song. We're not going to stop doing it, because why not talk about people who do good things? And so, like Sean said, tweet us, message us everywhere you go, and we'll try to get some of your friends and family on who've done great things, and you know, and talk about them and celebrate them, right?
Yeah, and I think that's what our podcast is about too. If you listen to it, the hero's journey of these guys. Mm-hmm. Guys don't just end up in the big leagues. Guys just don't end up Navy SEALs. Guys just don't end up starting companies. There's a journey along the way with no one. I like to say generational gratitude. No one in life gets to where they're going on their own back. They stand on the backs of so many people along the way. I love hearing that journey of the backs that these guys that have made it to the big leagues, made it to Cooperstown, yeah. made it as Navy SEALs or whatever you have, you know, made it as the first woman on you know, doing color, you know, made it in the first woman doing a, you know, a playoff game or whatever. You know, these women that are and men, you know, they've made it because of a lot of other people. I think that's yeah. what I love, the hero's journey. That's why it's been, I think that's why our show is awesome.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's part of, I love, and you know, now when, lucky enough, people are starting to watch our show. Thank you, everybody. But
yeah, yeah.
You know,
well, the reason we're still doing it is because people are actually watching.
Yeah, but
we're so grateful for that because just like this show,
yeah.
we stand on the backs of the listeners that are listening. Absolutely. So we appreciate it.
Yeah,
we
and now, when I reach out to some of these guests, I'm like, don't worry about the baseball stuff. It's really not. Of course, there's so much baseball and sports woven into what we're doing, but a lot of it, it's like, how did it start for you? That's my favorite thing. And not even ours, like listening to others. Like, I love hearing, how did you get to this point? How did you get to this point in your life, in your career? Who were the parents that influenced you? Who were the coaches? Who were the teachers? Who was all that stuff? And that's been my favorite part of the show. Listen, you know, when Jim told me, he talks about his big brothers and you know, remember we asked him about your sisters, could they go on the dates with you three big guys? And he was like, they were protected. Don't worry about it.
They were
like,
protected, yeah. Dude, speaking of that, bro, yeah. last night, Jim, for whatever reason, Tommy's, we went out one night. We went fishing yeah. with Tommy, and this picture popped up, and his brother Chuck is in this picture. I got to show you a picture of him.
Oh, the big guy?
Yeah, dude. That's why
I was like. His brothers are bigger than him, right? And this is Jim Tomei. We're talking about Jim Tomei here. They're bigger than him. Yeah, I would
say, if you ever think Jim Tomei's on steroids or did steroids, you should punch yourself directly in the face because you obviously don't know his family.
All right.
And these guys and his brother Chuck is a monster, and his dad just was huge too. I'm trying to, dude. How do I use this iPhone? Oh, favorites. Here it is, right here.
Okay.
Boom. Here it is. Here it is, right here.
Let's see, push it up to the screen here. I'm excited for this.
Okay, well, you know what, bro?
What are you doing? What's happening here?
I can't find it. Why can't I find it? I should be better than this by now, dude. I'm telling you.
Did he text it to you last night?
I hit favorites. No, it was something that popped up. It was,
oh, it was
a
like
picture.
A memory?
After a while, yeah.
Get a hold of yourself with your Apple, man.
Yeah, dude, I don't know, bro. You know what? I'm doing the best I can with the tools I have right now, okay, bro? It'll get better eventually.
All right. Well, if we get that picture, I'm going
to put it. But anyway, he's a monster. Doesn't matter. you don't need the picture. He's an absolute killer. I'll get you the picture. I'll find it somewhere.
Perfect.
All good right. show, everybody.
Yeah. Good. The other good thing we've done is we branched out a little bit, right? We're not just baseball anymore. How cool is it to have had Jeff Morrow, one of my favorite people in the world, Food Network guy.
Oh, Jeff was great, man. Jeff was great. Matter of fact, I'm not kidding you. When he was talking about butter and buns.
Yeah.
He's like, Casey's probably got a dozen butter buns to the outer edges. I'm like, dude, now I'm making burgers for the family. I'm like, I got to get the butter to the outer.
Jeff. Dude, I listen to every guy. I do everything that he told us to do all the time. Oh, my God. Jess did the hot dog bun thing. The trick with the hot dog buns where you can kind of like make them so it tastes like a dirty water dog in a city. She did it. She put up the bag in the grill. Go back and watch that episode. They are, dude, it tastes better than a Dodger dog when you make them at home.
Come on, dude. So wait, what do? You put it in a garbage, bag?
No, he takes them and puts them back in like the plastic wrap kind of thing. And it's like you steam them within the bag on the grill without burning them on a grill. I'm like, dude, I'll send you the link and whatever. Everybody go back and watch Tomorrow's show. It is game changer for dogs.
Guy's a comedian, dude. Yeah, guy's a comedian.
He's awesome. And then who else? We had Turtle from Entourage.
Jerry Ferrara.
Yeah, giving us the inside scoop.
Entourage was so good. Yeah. The Tom Brady story.
Yep, Tom Brady story,
so good.
When the Manning brothers ditched him and they needed somebody, and Brady showed up. Yeah. Crazy.
Mike O'Malley, our boy from Heels and Yes yep. Dear.
Yes,
great dude. He was at my house when we were doing it.
How about being at your house? What were those like? So who was in your house? We had Dempster in your house.
Dempster. We had Leland.
Leland in your house.
That was awesome. Remember, we couldn't get we only couldn't get both mics to work. We had one mic.
Oh my god!
Everyone's leaning in like, all right, this is bullshit.
That was probably the most intimidating episode we've ever done. Not just like he was great, and obviously he was so cool too.
You kept calling him sir. I think he wanted to punch you through the screen.
Like, but it was like you have a respect for him. Yeah. I have a respect for him. He doesn't know who the hell I am, and and he's in your house. I was so terrified, and that is actually, at this point, that is our number one episode. Oh, and we're coming up. In the next month or two, we're going to do the best of Jim Leland, because almost every single guest we've had on has had an unbelievable Jim Leland story. So look out for that coming down the road. And then you did the gravy thing. You and Graves were in a hotel room.
Because we were doing that Legends softball game, which was really cool. Yeah, we had Grilly at the house.
Glass in your house? Grilly, yes.
Really at the house, which was awesome. He came in with a couple of his rock and roll wine, bottle of wine.
Yeah.
And then Steve Blass was there, which was awesome.
So Blass, funny.
So funny. He didn't want to leave. I'm like, Blass.
Yeah.
He threw come back shoe. Part two. Dude, there's so many guys. There's so many guys too. When we're done, I'm like, I'm so glad we have that on video.
I know, dude.
These guys are legends. Yes. We have them on video. We could tell the stories. Like even with Blass. The Clemente stories, the Willie Mays stories, the Hank Aaron stories. Incredible.
Yes, incredible. Like, incredible. How about Brian Jordan talking about hitting behind Mark McGwire during batting practice and everybody booing him for an entire year when McGwire was trying to hit his 70th homer every time he would come out of cage. I mean, there's so many. I apologize that we have not named every single person we've had on so far, because, man, we're so thankful for him. And the story is really...
Jeff Bagwell, Berkman talking to us for over 2 hours. You know, his stories were unbelievable.
Oh, how about the other fun thing? And I've said this before, and I've posted some of this stuff, but, like, my favorite thing... Don't mind my Macy's barking upstairs, but whatever. How about when we set up, when we turn our cameras on, and then the person pops in... To me, these people that know Sean, and like obviously they've been such close friends, and all they do is rag each other, these guys, especially like pro athletes, like whatever. Oh my god, the best one ever was Todd Frazier. What happened? Explain that story.
We're getting Frazier on. He's like, Case, you know, he was having trouble getting on. Remember, we're like, man, you just hit this button. All right, hang on a second. It's like, and his kid just drops an unbelievable bomb right in his pants. Oh, come on. You think it was disgusting? But I had it on my phone, and you were recording me, and I had him on my phone because we were trying to get him hooked up. But we have the whole thing on when he was talking to his son about pooping his pants. It was epic.
Unbelievable. I might flip that in.
He's like, man, this is disgusting. You can't do that, you know? Oh, my God. Oh,
so good, man. So good. So much fun. And then, I mean, what else, man? Before, you know what? Let's... Why don't we take like a quick break from what our show is and talk about something that really happened, because we'd be remiss if we didn't get your take on this real quick, and we'll move back on to the show. But one of the greatest legends in history, forget about sports, just pop culture, life in general, Vin Scully passed away a couple days ago, and we just want to celebrate him a little bit, right?
Well, you know, it's Chinch, I've had the most blessed life, grateful life. Like, it's crazy that a guy like Vin Scully, when he passes, obviously he's a baseball legend. He's more than baseball. He was a voice of the Brooklyn Dodgers, the LA Dodgers. You know, grew up a New York Giants fan. Did it for 67 years. Did some golf. Did some NBA. Did some NFL. You know, just legend, absolute legend. And I remember when I was like my second year in the big leagues, 1999 or 2000. I'm in the Dodgers clubhouse. And I get a pat on my shoulder, and I hear that voice. And he's like, "Hey, Sean, I just want to introduce myself. I'm Vin Scully." And I'm like, it was like the first time I was ever speechless, Chinch. I was like, I didn't know what to say. Wow. And it was like, I swear to God, I had like an out-of-body experience. Like, I'm talking to Vin Scully in the clubhouse, and he's talking to me, "Hey, I just want to introduce myself." Like, the kindest dude ever. Like, just that's who Vin was. Recognized everybody. And I was kind of new in the league, and I was having some success, so he wanted to come down and introduce himself. And it literally, as he was talking to me, asking me where I'm from and everything like that, I'm having an out-of-body experience. Yeah. Like, is this being recorded? Am I on TV? And my brain just had Vin Scully's voice, but he's right in front of me. He's talking to me. And I'm like, this is incredible.
Unbelievable.
Absolutely incredible that Vin Scully's talking to me. And then we'll have to go see if we can find the clip. But a couple years ago, Clayton Kershaw dominating again, onto another Cy Young, doing his thing. Someone sent me a clip on Twitter that Vin Scully in the booth was talking about. I was the first big leaguer that Clayton Kershaw ever faced. Right. And to give you the story again, I mean, we might have told him this on the show, but it's worth it. Another go was my last year with the Red Sox in 2008. We're playing, we're in Vero Beach. We're playing the Dodgers. Joe Torre is the manager. Larry Bowa is the bench coach. And it's like my third at bat. And, you know, I'm just trying to get, you know, my last at bat in. And I look out on the mound and, you know, it's a guy I don't recognize. So, you know, we don't, you know, I go to Dave Magadan. He's number 96. Guy's like 6'6", number 96, lefty. That's why I say to Dave Magadan, our hitting coach. I'm like, Mags, I'm like, you got anything on this guy? He's like, nah, I don't know. I don't got anything. So I go to Tito. I'm like, Tito, you got anything on this guy? He goes, just like a minor league player they're looking to get some innings to. You know what I mean? So then I was like, all right, cool. So I'm like, all right, I'll get up there. I'm going to take a pitch, see what this guy has. Like, bam, 98 outside black. I'm like, I look over at Joe Torre and Larry Bowa. They're kind of giggling because they're like, they know something I don't know. Like, I feel like this is like, I feel like I'm on a show pranked. Like, is this a joke? You know, is there a hidden camera here, on candid camera? Next pitch, bro. Nasty hook. Think it's going to hit me in the face. I kind of back up. Bam, strike two. I'm like, that's one of the greatest hooks I've ever seen. Like, this can't be Joe Blow from the backfields they're trying to give an inning to. Like, this guy is somebody different. Next pitch throws me another heater down the way for strike three, but they call it a ball because I'm like, okay, obviously the umpire does. Number 96. This is my 12th year in the big leagues. Like, oh, we're going to give Sean Casey the benefit of the doubt. Ball. Next pitch, bro. Hooks me again. Buckled. Tony's frozen pizza. Johnny Buckle sandwich. I'm backing up. Strike three. I look over at Torre, Larry Bowa. They're like, they're giggling. They got their hats like, laughing. I'm like, oh, my God. Turns out, bro, it's Clayton Kershaw. I'm the first big leaguer he ever faced, right? In the middle of that year, night in 2008, he gets called up, dominates, and I'm like, I feel so much better about myself now. Because number 96, who's now whatever 22, is dominating big leaguers at an epic rate, and so it turns out they're the best lefties in baseball history. But Scully told that story. And somebody sent it on Twitter, like, how cool is it that Vin Scully's repeating back, and he said something like the great Sean Casey or something.
That's so, you know, cool. Kind of
helping up a story, as only Vin Scully could tell a story. The greatest storyteller sports has ever seen.
It's not even close. I watched
Bo Porter told a story last night, really quick. Told a story last night on MLB Tonight. He was saying that when he was the manager of the Dodgers, manager of the Astros, they came to play the Dodgers, and Bo would run the stairs every day before the game at like noon. So he's running the stairs, 7 o'clock game at night, looked up in the booth, boom, there's Vin Scully with his papers spread out, doing his 7 hours before the game, dude.
Oh my God.
He's got his research guy giving him some stories, helping, but he's doing a lot of the research himself. Incredible.
Unbelievable. So incredible. Great.
Rest in peace, Vin.
Rest in peace. I got, just from a production, from the producer standpoint, I've got to meet him. I was lucky enough to meet him a few times too, just generally whatever. But the storytelling, he's a poet. A poet. It gets through Buckner. That's the sentence he said. It gets through Buckner, and that's exactly what happened. But in that moment, just like that, to have those words all come together in that perfect, perfect sentence on the fly, amazing. I never saw him miss a home run call, anything, even towards the end. And finally, I got to I was producing the night of his very last game ever when he did the you ever know you're my hero? They played the music. Yeah, and I was like, it was one of the greatest moments. I'm like, wow, I'm sitting here while Vin Scully is calling a game for the very last time ever. I was sweating. It's so amazing. So rest in peace. You deserve whatever rest you got. I hope you're up there watching games and playing with all the old guys you covered, man, because we were lucky to have him.
The greatest thing, Chinch, is that when you hear Vin talk, he talks about his faith and how blessed he was that God would give him 67 years. This is a quote, like 67 years in the booth, you know, and just, you know, the guy that loved the New York Giants growing up, the little kid that always thought about, you know, sneaking into the games. And mm-hmm. And now here he was, one of the greatest broadcasters ever. So what a run, man. 94. did it right every day, man.
Absolutely. So great.
So cool.
Yeah. All right. So we're in a
Dude, really quick, let's just touch on this for a second. Yeah. But the Juan Soto deal, bro.
Oh.
How unbelievable is that? I was on air. Talk about another great moment. Thank you. Thank you for this one.
Yeah.
I was on MLB Central the other day with D. Rowe and Lauren Shahadi. And remember, we were talking, you know, that show's on from 9 to 1 on MLB Network. And we were just saying to ourselves, well, I hope somebody gets traded during this 9 to 1 hour because, you know.
Yeah, it's a grind.
The deadline's at 6 o'clock. And so we thought the Soto deal would get done at like 5:59, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It turns out it gets done at like 11:45. J.P. Morosi breaks the news. And here we go. We're on. And we're talking about all the prospects they got back and all that. But Juan Soto last night, I don't know if you saw the game in San Diego.
Yeah. Oh, so cool, dude.
It's electric. So many people. It's so great for baseball. You're talking Manny Machado, Juan Soto, Tatis is coming back. You know, they just Brandon Drury they traded for. Josh Bell's in that lineup.
Yep.
I mean, top to bottom, bro. All of a sudden, we're fired up for the San Diego Padres.
Yeah,
even
dude.
To match up with the Dodgers now.
Yeah, look at those two teams.
Musgrove, Darvish, all those guys, man.
Those two teams, I would say about a year and a half ago, you'd be like, all right, well, it's the Dodgers division for the next 5 years, at least with all the superstars. I cannot believe. And you know what? The Padres have tried to make the big moves over the years, and they've gotten some guys, and they haven't worked out this lineup.
Right.
Can I tell you something? When he was running out there, I'm like, huh, there's that built in that uniform. You know who it reminds me of? Tony Gwynn, dude.
Tony Gwynn.
Dude, similar size, similar frame, and in that uniform, I was like, wow, this guy could be the next great superstar hitter in that lineup, you know, in the same spot, two hole, where Tony Gwynn, two or three hole. Man, it's very cool to see. I love that stuff, man. I love a good trade. I love a good trade.
That's incredible. That's one of the greatest trades ever. He's a generational player. He's 23 years old.
Yeah.
His numbers right now compared to Ted Williams, you know what I mean, as far as you know, like OPS plus and on-base percentage and just everything that he does. I mean, he's so special. Bo Porter was saying another point last night when he was doing some pregame, postgame for the Nationals. Juan Soto would always come to spring training and say, got to make the team this year. I'm here to make the team. And he was serious.
It. Yes, I love that. I see, you can see that.
The mentality of like, I got to prove myself. I got to do it year in and year out. So
you can see that in him for sure.
Baseball, man.
Yeah, I root for him. He just seems like the right person and everything. And, you know, I got to give Harold Reynolds credit. He always says this. He goes, you want to be the number one paid player. You want to be the biggest guy. You got to be a good person too. From all we've seen from Juan Soto, you know, man, if you put me there, 23 years old with $37 million a year in a bank, I'd be in the rafters right now. You'd be like, where's Chinch? Oh, he's probably dead in a doorstep somewhere. I mean, so the quality of person is just
he's making a lot of bad decisions. He needs the heroic app at ASAP.
Yeah, exactly. anyway, yeah, but so that's it, man. We've been doing this. This is our 100th episode. May 2021 we started.
Let's go, dude. Let's go, man. It's been a lot of fun. But Chinch, thing I love about it, dude, is it's marginal gains. It's compound pounding. You know, the more we do it, the more we show up, the more we see fans joining us, the more people follow us, the more people are downloading us, and the more excited we get to keep going, do it every day. So congrats to you, bro, for showing
up,
all the things you do for this, you know, for this show. It's absolutely incredible the work that you put in. I can't be more grateful to have a partner like you. Caitlin Moyer, who's been awesome for us, who has stepped up in so many different ways, puts out the press release every day, has helped us socially in our social media and all that stuff to understand this business. Just so many different guys, so many different people. Sarah, you know, and Jess.
Yep.
You know, our girls that have, you know, helped us
get
this thing going. Matt Bonnet, who's, you know, helped us set up the mics. And also got to thank Rennell and Ron for doing their things, getting us some ads out on Facebook. But I think if we keep going down that road, we might be broke one day, Chinch, at some point. But let's go. I mean, it was a shit show at the beginning with the mics. Remember the one thing was, sounds like these guys are in a bathroom stall.
Yeah.
I was like, we do, Chinch. We sounds like a bathroom stall. Like, we got to clean it up. I've spent like $8,000 on mics. I have so many freaking mics around my house.
I've given them around to everybody. I'm like, hey, take these. I don't know what to do with this. I have one here I've never used. I don't know what this is, but it's like trial and error, man. But yeah, it does all come back to the fans too. And we got a lot of tweets today.
Big Mike, we just brought on Big Mike too. who's coming on to help us do some things.
Oh, Big Mike. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we're trying to go to another level, so we're hiring the right people. So
absolutely. Absolutely. So I want to read off just real quick and give some props to some of our fans who've been some of our most consistent fans, and they all tweeted at you when you announced we were doing this. By the way, shout out to the Pat McAfee Show, because those guys could not have been – they are the biggest cheerleaders for us, and I would argue that they have the greatest show on – Going right now.
Pat McAfee's a Pittsburgher, bro. Yeah, guy's a freaking legend. He's a great guy, and he does it. And one of the hardest working dudes. And he's on wrestling too, which I love. So I tune into wrestling and hear what McAfee has to say. So every time I go on that show, bro, I'm very grateful.
That's it's so awesome.
Great energy, dude. Great energy. Let's go.
So good. Yeah. So speaking of great energy, here I'm the first guy. This guy is one of our biggest fans and one of the best dudes. Mark Ruggiero. Haven't missed one show. Fired up every time you guys produce a new one. Get a fanboy show in the works. I'm your man. Keep up the great work, boys. Well, Mark's been great. Here's another one. Lauren Anderson. Okay. What were you going to say?
No, Mark's the best, man. Mark's the best. Mark and I go way back, dude. We go back to the Boston days. Mm-hmm. You know, Mark Ruggiero, like he's part of the SWAT team out there in Boston.
Wow.
Was one of the guys that helped when they got the bombers, and the Boston Marathon bombers, was one of the guys in that patrol. I met him years ago, I believe, when Ed Vedder did Theo's and Peter have that
the music foundation
later. Yeah, Mark and I met up backstage, and we've been friends ever since. So we appreciate and we also sent him the first mayor's office T-shirt.
Yeah, and he rocks it, and that dude is jacked.
He sent me a picture of the day, him and Hulk Hogan. Bigger pipes than Hogan, dude.
That fights
got like 28. Hogan's got 25. Mark's got 28-inch pythons. Yeah,
that's unbelievable. A couple more just from the fans. Lauren Anderson talking about their favorite episodes. Congrats on 100th of the mayor's office. My favorite was Steve Blass. How about that? Also asked, what about having Coach Malarkey on the show?
Coach Malarkey is my high school coach. We're definitely getting Coach Malarkey on at some point. No doubt about it. He just retired, too. 30-plus years. Guy still looks like he was my coach 30 years ago. I'm like, you don't age, Mr. Malarkey. You don't age.
Oh, another one I want to mention, Holly McCarthy. She's always constantly tweeting our shows out, whatever. She just said congratulations on 100.
Yeah, thanks, Holly.
Sean Chinch, you're a great fan. We do really, really do appreciate you. Let me see if there's a couple other whack. This one writes, this is from John Morrison. Watched every one of these episodes. I can't come up with a top 10. Too many favorites. Thank you.
Thanks, John.
What else we got here? A couple more. Oh, this person. Who is this? I want to make sure. Landy Townsend. Sean, you and Chinch put together a great podcast week after week. My personal favorites were, here we go, Danny Graves, Hume, the Meat Hook, and Adam Dunn, and Pete Harness. So clearly a Cincinnati Reds fan.
Must be a Reds fan. Thank you.
And to all the folks, honestly, I there's so many here. I can't read them all, but we've seen them all, and we'll probably reply to all you guys. And our YouTube fans, there's so many great people who literally consistently, I'm actually going to name one right now because he literally writes every single week. Let me pull up our YouTube page here. Stand by. Yeah, here we go. This is like when you tried to find the...
I couldn't find the Tomy picture.
Yeah, hold on. I gotta give this guy a shout out because he literally comments on every single one of our shows and has such... William Clifford. That's his name. Will Clifford. He's constantly on our YouTube page. I hope more of you people who are listening go to our YouTube page because, like I said, some of the stuff we talk about here, we get visuals of. We put them on there trying to make it a little TV show. So, but at the end of the day, that's, you know... We just want to thank you all. Thank you all so much for being a part of this. We know who you are. The people who have been with us from the very beginning, we literally know all your names. We do. And we try to comment back to you guys as much as we can and thank you and retweet your stuff. But we wouldn't be doing this without you. And we wouldn't be kind of going, oh, wow, then maybe this is something we can do for a while without knowing that there are people actually watching and listening and that we'll be able to kind of like give our messages along to them. And all of the heart that Sean has is one of my best friends in the world and one of the best people I've ever met. And I love hearing him kind of be so enthusiastic, you, Sean, about the way of your life now, the way you live your life now, the way you've learned and the way you're trying to pass that along to everybody else. Yeah. It's one of the greatest experiences of my life, of my career and everything. So I love you so much, man.
Love you too, brother. And I'm very grateful for you, and I'm grateful for all this. And I'm really grateful for all the fans that are listening. And also too, throw out some guests that you want to hear. Yeah. We'll make every effort to get them. We're not as big time as Howard Stern or something like that, but we'll do everything we can to get those guests.
Yeah. Hey, I got one.
We will find a contact.
We've done 100 now. Do you think you can get your boy Eddie Vedder on? We've done.
Oh, yeah, it's going to come on at some point. He's touring right now, though. He's busy. Right,
that's fine.
We'll get Ed on. We're going to track him down at some point.
Excellent. Beautiful. All right. Well, that's it. There's 100. We got 100.
All right, bro. Hey, to the next 100, to the next 100, to the next 100, to the next 100. Compound pounding, brother. Yeah. You got to keep hitting the pinata. You never know when that candy's going to fall. Let's go, baby.
Let's go.
Candy, I don't know what the number's got to be for the candy to fall because we haven't made a dollar on this. As a matter of fact, I think I'm going broke doing this podcast. Other than that, bro, let's keep going and let's keep dominating. And if I'm living on a shack by the beach one day, I'm probably not at the beach. A shack down by the river. Figure you'll know that I spent every money on this podcast and it didn't work out. Let's go.
Let's go. All right, bro.
Love you. Love you, Chinchy. See you, brother.